Good morning. Welcome to this time of worship with First Baptist Church of Fort Payne, Alabama. I'm Marshall Henderson, the pastor of First Baptist Church. Our church exists because of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And we believe that the gospel is at the very heart of the message of the Bible, and it's at the very heart of who we are as God's people. It means that the gospel forms every part of our lives, and it informs every dimension of who we are and what we do as God's people. So in light of the gospel, we live for the sake of Jesus Christ. And we desire as a church to make Jesus Christ known through heartfelt worship, through disciple making, through missional living, and through devoting ourselves to one another in community. So today, however you're watching, I want you to know that the desire of our leadership is that you enter into a genuine and heartfelt time of worship with us as a church. Jesus is worthy of our praise, and he is worthy of all of our attention and our affection. And now, for all who are weary and need rest, and for all who mourn and long for comfort, and for all who fail and desire strength, and for all who sin and need a Savior, this church opens wide its doors to you. You are welcomed into worship this morning with a welcome that comes from Jesus Christ. Welcome to worship.
Good morning, friends. Welcome to worship this morning with First Baptist Church of Fort Payne. If you are a guest with us, we hope you feel especially welcome this morning. If you are a guest, there are guest information cards located in the pew racks in front of you, or there's a little laminated card. You can also find a guest information card electronically through a QR code, but those are there in front of you. If you're a guest this morning and you have children going to children's church, later on in the service, they leave in the middle of service. That's for pre-K through first grade. There's a name tag in the pew rack in front of you as well, a part to put on the child, a part for you to keep, and so just a couple notes of instruction there. As we gather for worship this morning, I'm reminded of words from John Piper that God is most glorified in us when we are most satisfied in him. So God has designed our souls to be satisfied in worshiping him. As we come in here together this morning, we know that Jesus comes to each of us, and he says to each of us, come to me and drink, come to me and be filled, come to me and out of your heart will flow rivers of life. And so this morning as we gather for worship, we simply say yes. We come to him. He is the one who can fill us and satisfy us and save us. And in him, we overflow with joy. And so I say to you this morning, as I say to you often, for all who are weary and need rest, and for all who mourn and long for comfort, and for all who fail and desire strength, and for all who sin and need a Savior, this church opens wide its doors to you because Jesus Christ, the Lord, has opened wide his arms to you. Welcome to worship with a welcome that comes from the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, as we begin our time of worship, as Christ has welcomed you into his presence, we also want to welcome one another. I invite you to stand in these moments of passing the peace. Say hello to someone around you. Greet someone around you. Everybody come shake Myla's hand, who put something on Facebook about this yesterday. You can look at Facebook later. Let's welcome one another. Stand. Well, if you would, as you make your way back to your seats, please remain standing. Our call to worship this morning is from John chapter 6. It will be here on the screen in front of you. I'll read the portions printed in white if you'll join with me in the portions printed in yellow. The words of Jesus. Our Father ate manna in the wilderness. As it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat. Jesus then said to them, truly, truly, I say to you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but my Father gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he who has come down from heaven and gives life to the world. And they said to him, sir, give us this bread always. Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger, and whoever believes in me shall never thirst. Let's worship together.
If you will remain standing, you find at the hymn 611 the familiar Jordan Stormy Banks. Notice I've asked that you all sing the first two stanzas and the last stanza, and the choir is going to treat that third stanza in a way maybe to draw attention to what that text says. But let's sing together, Jordan Stormy Banks.
I am bound for the promised land.
Thank you. You may be seated.
Good morning. Boys and girls, I want you to think about your favorite thing to eat for breakfast. Some of you might love pancakes, or maybe you like bacon and eggs, or maybe you eat cereal. Now, I want you to imagine that you could wake up in the morning, open your front door, and your breakfast would be sitting there on your front lawn. That'd be kind of neat, wouldn't it? Well, do you know something like that actually happened to the Israelites, God's special people? After they were freed from slavery, God led them on a journey to their new home. But they had to walk through the wilderness to get there. And as they walked through the wilderness, they began to be afraid. They were afraid that God wasn't going to take care of them. They began to complain to Moses. They were afraid that they were going to starve to death. Exodus 16 tells us, "The Lord said to Moses, 'I've heard the grumbling of the people of Israel. Say to them, at twilight, you shall eat meat, and in the morning, you shall be filled with bread. Then you shall know that I am the Lord your God.' So every evening, quail would cover the ground where they were, and they would have meat to eat. And every morning, something called manna would cover the ground, so the Israelites would have a sweet bread to eat. God took care of his people. They shouldn't have complained against God. If he could part the sea and bring them safely through it, then he would surely take care of his children." We've memorized a special verse this month. Psalm 46:1 reminds us that God will also take care of us no matter what trouble we're facing. Read that verse with me, please. "God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble." Psalm 46:1. Let's pray and thank God for his care for us. Father, we just thank you for your love and your faithfulness and all the ways you take care of us. Father, help us to see you at work in our lives. Father, help us to trust you. Help us to know that you love us and that you are working things for our good and your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
The choir sings now an anthem entitled Cornerstone. It draws from passages from the Psalms, Isaiah, John, and 1 Corinthians, entitled Cornerstone by Sean Kirshner.
The stone that the builders reject.
This is Smith. Last Sunday, he came up to me after church, and he said, during your sermon, I was reading the Bible. I was like, well, you could have listened, but he said, I was reading the Bible, and he said, I found this prayer in 1 Samuel, and he said simply, I think everyone should hear this prayer. And so I said to him, I think you're right. And so Hannah's prayer from 1 Samuel chapter 2 will guide us in our prayer as a congregation this morning.
My heart exults in the Lord, my horn is exalted in the Lord. My mouth derides my enemies because I rejoice in your salvation. There is none holy like the Lord, for there is none besides you. There is no rock like our Lord. Talk no more so very proudly. Let not arrogance come from your mouth. For the Lord is a God of knowledge, and by him actions are weighed. The bows of the mighty are broken, but the feeble bind on strength. Those who were full have hired themselves out for bread, but those who are hungry have ceased to hunger. The barren has borne seven, but she who has many children is forlorn. The Lord kills and brings to life. He brings down Sheol and raises up. The Lord makes poor and makes rich. He brings low and he exalts. He raises up the poor from the dust. He lifts the needy from the ash heap to make them sit with princes and inherit a seat of honor. For the pillars of the earth are the Lord's, and on them he has set the world. He will guard the feet of his faithful ones, but the wicked he shall cut off in darkness. For not by might shall a man prevail. The adversaries of the Lord shall be broken to pieces. Against them he will thunder in heaven. The Lord will judge the ends of the earth. He will give strength to his king, and he will exalt his horn of the anointed.
Amen. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, these words in Hannah's prayer resonate in our hearts as we, like her, gather together to praise you as our rock and our redeemer. We worship you in awe, knowing that there is no one holy like you, God. Yet you have chosen to reveal yourself to us and to come to us by taking on our humanity, to show us your love and your mercy in person. In Jesus taking the form of a servant, you taught us about your power. You have power beyond our understanding. You have love that we cannot wrap our minds around. You have a deep, personal, specific compassion on the weak and on the needy. You save sinners and you raise them up to life, and we praise you for that. We praise you that your power is leveraged to lift the weak, power in service to others, raising up the powerless, strengthening the weak, healing the sick, replacing despair with hope, and bringing life when there is death. We praise you. That is how you use your power, God. And we pray that we'd see your power and compassion at work in our community, in our world. This morning, as a church, we pray for the poor, for provision of their need. We pray for those who are lonely, that you surround them with love. We pray for security for widows. We pray for a home for orphans. We pray for those who are in sick and in pain to experience healing and relief. And in this faith family, we pray for a community of love and hospitality, a place to be at home and to belong. We pray for grace and truth to reign among us. Use our hands to be of service to those in need. Use our voices to speak words of healing and encouragement to those who are in distress. This morning, Lord, we praise you, we adore you. You, God, are a God of wonderful promises. We pray that this time of worship may be a worthy response to all of your holiness and all of your love. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
To finish our time of prayer, I invite you to pray, or in this case, sing the prayer that our Lord taught us to pray, the Lord's Prayer. Please stand. Let's all sing together.
Our Father.
You may be seated. Next in our service, one of the newer songs that we're learning, I Stand in Awe. I've asked Eleanor if she would reintroduce that to you, let you hear how that melody goes again. The choir will even jump in on the chorus, and then we'll sing the rest of it as you're comfortable. You'll see it on the screen there in front of you. This is I Stand in Awe.
When I consider what you have made, the mighty oceans, the fiery stars, the fields and forests, give you praise, my Lord, my God.
I stand.
We sing next the great hymn of faith, Great is Thy Faithfulness, found in your hymnal at number 96. Please, I'll ask that you stand, and we can sing together.
Thank you.
remain standing. Our children are going to come forward. We'll remain for our scripture reading first, and then you'll be seated.
This week's scripture reading is from Exodus 16, 1 through 12. They set out from Elim, and all the congregation of the people of Israel came to the wilderness of Sin, which is between Elim and Sinai, on the 50th day of the second month after they had departed from the land of Egypt. And the whole congregation of the people of Israel grumbled against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. And the people of Israel said to them, "Would that we had died by the hand of the Lord in this, would that we have died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the meat pots and ate bread to the full, for you have brought us into this wilderness to kill the whole assembly with hunger." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Behold, I am about to rain bread from heaven for you, and the people shall go out and gather a day's portion every day, that I may test them whether they will walk in my law or not. On the sixth day, when they prepare what they bring in, it will be twice as much as they gather daily." So Moses and Aaron said to all the people of Israel, "At evening you shall know that it was the Lord who brought you out of the land of Egypt. And in the morning you shall see the glory of the Lord, because he has heard your grumbling against the Lord. For what are we that you grumble against us?" And Moses said, "When the Lord gives you the evening meat to eat, and in the morning bread to the full, because of the Lord has heard your grumbling that you grumble against him, what are we? Your grumbling is not against us, but against the Lord." Then Moses said to Aaron, "Say to the whole congregation of the people of Israel, come near before the Lord, for he has heard your grumbling." And as soon as Aaron spoke to the whole congregation of the people of Israel, they looked toward the wilderness, and behold, the glory of the Lord appeared in the cloud. And the Lord said to Moses, "I have heard your grumbling of the people of Israel. Say to them, at twilight you shall eat meat, and in the morning you shall be filled with bread. Then you shall know that I am the Lord your God." This is the word of the Lord.
So Israel is out of their chains. They have crossed the Red Sea. They are told in our passage before this one to be silent and see the salvation of the Lord. And these are all mountaintop moments. We might refer to them that way. They're these bits and pieces within the biblical story, within our story, where God seems most evident. These are the moments you would think, out of the chains, walking out of Egypt, crossing the Red Sea. You would think those are the salvation moments. Those are the high, holy, transcendent moments. In fact, if you looked at your life, you might think of moments like that as those are the moments that you would label God saving me, right? And everything else after that or between those times, that belongs in that miscellaneous drawer, you know, like you have everybody has in their kitchen, right? Just kind of the, I'm going to call it the junk drawer, but the miscellaneous drawer of God stuff, right? So big salvation moments and then the rest is just God stuff. But I would say no. I would say that every interaction you have with God is for the purpose of your salvation. Now, broadly speaking, salvation in the fullest extent, every interaction you have with God is for your salvation in an ongoing way until it reaches completeness in the presence of God forever. Every interaction you have with God is for the death in you being raised to life, for the slavery in you becoming freedom, for the poverty of your soul becoming richness of soul, for your cold life becoming radiant. Every interaction with God. And you think about this passage, this is one of those passages that's like this. What's this passage really about? Is it about the miracle? Is it about quail coming in at the right time? Is it about bread from heaven? Well, there certainly is a miracle here. The bread is miraculous. In fact, they'd never seen it before when they gathered it off the ground, so much so that the name of it, manna, actually derives from just asking the question, what is this? Right? That's the name. The bread was called, what is this? It's like when I got married, I learned about all kinds of new foods, right? One of those foods is couscous. Does anybody know what couscous is? Who doesn't know what couscous is? This is not an embarrassing moment. I didn't. Yeah, just be proud. Couscous is like if grits and rice had a baby. We're Christians. It's like grits and rice got married and had a baby, right? Right? This is what manna was. What is this? What is this in front of me? And couscous is great, by the way. Love it. Love it. Love it, dear. They're living each day in a miracle. For 40 years, God provides. They're living on the tangible reality that God opens his hand and provides for their needs to sustain them. There's no life without God opening his hand. So it is partly that, but think about the story. It actually begins with deadly grumbling. They grumble against their leaders, which God translates as grumbling against him, a rebellious complaining against the Lord. And by his grace, as they grumble against their leaders, as they grumble rebelliously against the Lord, by his grace, they don't face judgment. In fact, what God does in response is God provides daily bread so that they may live. Why, though? Why would God have that response to the grumble? You don't take care of us, God. Here's bread every day. Is God trying to reward brats in the desert, right? Is God a bad parent like we are sometimes? And I'd say this. I'd say God's plan is to disciple the Israelites. God knows that beneath their complaint to Moses and Aaron and their complaint to him, although they don't abandon the faith, it's actually a functional distrust in everything God says. Now, they don't walk away completely from the faith in their whole wilderness journey. It's a functional distrust in how God runs the world. Maybe for us, right? We're not walking away from the faith, perhaps, today. Is there within us a functional distrust in everything God says? Is there a functional distrust in how God might run his world? God gets to the heart of the complaint. And God really speaks to the heart of the complaint. The complaint actually becomes the thing that God reveals about himself through this diet of daily bread. The thing that they need to know about him. How God runs the world. God runs the world with divine power plus divine compassion. And the message to them through this is that that is everything you need. His divine power, his divine compassion, that's everything you need. So the passage is about discipleship, God making disciples, putting to death what is deadly in them to cultivate what is life-giving among them. You might use that for an idea of discipleship. So let me say it this way. Let's talk about this passage this way, and then we'll define some terms and kind of walk through it a little bit. Here's what God is doing. God provides daily in order to starve the grumbler and feed the disciple. God provides daily in order to starve the grumbler and feed the disciples. So let's talk about terms. What's a disciple? Well, I'm interested in these master classes that are online. Maybe you've seen an ad for those as you watch TV or you surf YouTube or something like that. There's these master classes. They're video lessons given by the world's greatest teachers. So you could study comedy with Steve Martin. That'd be fun, right? You could study shooting and ball handling with Steph Curry. Cooking with Gordon Ramsay, or my favorite, which my wife makes fun of, is you can study sleight of hand with Penn and Teller, which is fascinating. I like sleight of hand magic, and I get made fun of it at home all the time. But it's fascinating. And you can think of discipleship like that, the God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, in a very tangible way, Jesus is inviting us into his master class. And this is actually the really good news of the whole thing. Dallas Willard's words from Renovation of the Heart. The really good news for humanity is that Jesus is now taking students into the master class of life. So Jesus, when he walked the earth, he said, "Follow me." That's the idea behind discipleship. Once you receive the gospel, once you receive Jesus Christ, you are a disciple. It is not an optional elective for Christians, right? I was in college, I was an accounting major, and then I was a psych major. But somewhere in the middle of that, I took badminton as an elective, right? What does it have to do with the main thing? It doesn't. But discipleship is not an elective like that to help you along in life. There's no nuance needed here. There's a clarity given to you at conversion. Once you receive Christ, you step into the world of being a disciple. So discipleship is a disciple is a lifelong follower and learner of Jesus Christ. What are you learning? You're learning the heart of God. You're learning the contour of God's smile. You are learning the works and ways of God. So a lifelong follower and learner of Jesus Christ who is growing spiritually and being formed into the image of Jesus, as you follow. Our goal might be this morning that we would just, in a very healthy way, be able to look out and look within and just say, I am a disciple of Jesus. In that pathway and following that way, the result of that is salvation in the fullest extent. Every provision of God in your life is to feed the disciple. Let's talk about grumblers. This will be fun. What is it to grumble? Some of you are like, I know firsthand. Okay, what is it to grumble? Is it to complain? Is it simply just to complain and have a problem? Does God just not want feedback on what's going wrong and what's going right? Does God not want us to be honest? Does God not want us to bring our problems to Him? No, that's not the meaning of grumbling. We actually find God in Scripture is incredibly gracious to hear our needs when we voice our complaints. And in Exodus 16, there actually is a legitimate question. We're in the desert. How are we going to eat, right? There's a legitimate worry here. So it's not that. It's not asking God, give us this day our daily bread. It's not that, right? I mean, that's a prayer of need, isn't it? You know, Jesus taught his disciples to pray that prayer. Give us each day our daily bread. We've sung it together and prayed it together this morning. In Hannah's prayer that we've read this morning, God sees and God knows the hurts of the barren and the poor and the hungry and the weak. In the book of Psalms, basically the book of Psalms is an invitation saying, take your pain and sing it to me, what God says to us. So to grumble is not to lament. Lament is a wonderful word. We don't use it as often as we probably should, but 2/3 of the Psalms are Psalms of lament. They're labeled that way. There's a whole book of the Bible about lamenting, lamentations. And lament is born out of a deep recognition that sin and suffering have pervaded everything in the human experience. Lamenting is for those who are going through the slog of difficulty and decay and pain and death. And yet, a lament is different than a grumble. A grumble is an accusation. A grumble is a complaint against God that maligns his character. That's what's happening in Exodus 16. It's not, God, we need you. It's, God, what are you doing? But a lament is an appeal to God in your pain based on confidence in his character. We lament when we go to God with our pain, longing to see God respond in justice. We go to him in our pain, knowing that confidently that our future and our hope doesn't rest in human hands. There's no comfort in that. But knowing that it rests in God's hands. So here in Exodus 16, we have a grumble. We have a deadly, rebellious complaint. We have an accusation spoken first against the leaders, Moses and Aaron. And it's funny, if you go back and look in the first couple of verses here, verse 3, they grumble against Moses and Aaron. They have these short memories. They have these shackled hearts. And they say something like this. Remember Egypt? We just sat around with bread and meat. Remember slavery? It was awesome. That's what they're saying. We had such full bellies. We're just going to lean back and die at a ripe old age, full-bellied and happy. Remember that, Moses and Aaron? He brought us out to the desert. It's dysfunctional distrust in what God says. There's an old song, well, maybe just old, song by Rich Mullins, Hold Me Jesus. It used to be big. It was a big song. And one of his lyrics says, surrender don't come natural to me. Sounds better when he sings it. I'd rather fight you for something I don't really want than take what you give me that I need. It's so true of our lives, isn't it? Give me the slavery I know rather than the immense waters of grace. Give me the idol that I know, the idol that I know will mistreat me rather than a God who cannot be fathomed. I prefer the predictability of slavery over the adventure of freedom. So it's this distrust in how God runs the world. You know what grumbling is? Kind of just in a little short way of describing this. Grumbling, it's an eye roll. Perhaps we have people in our lives that we have such contempt for. Maybe it's just me. We have such a quarrel with that in our view of them, their life, and everything we say, we have such contempt for them that it's always met with an eye roll, right? Do you have people like that? God identifies in this passage to Moses and Aaron and to the people, you haven't just rolled your eyes at your leaders, you've rolled them at me. I am that I am. I will reveal myself and who I am, how I reveal myself and who I am. And you don't know the first thing about me. And here's the danger in grumbling, is that you will lose yourself, you will lose everything in your grumbling. C.S. Lewis said it this way, hell begins with a grumbling mood, always complaining, always blaming others, but you are still distinct from it. You may even criticize it in yourself and wish you could stop it. But there may come a day when you can no longer, then there will be no you left to criticize the mood or to even enjoy it, but just the grumble itself going on and on forever like a machine. It's not a question of God sending us to hell. It is God, it is hell. It is something growing within us that unless we nip it in the bud will be called hell in us. A grumble dismantles the source of good, the source of compassion, the source of rest, the source of hope inside of you until there's nothing less but to be faithless and hopeless and restless and void of good and shriveling in your life. You see what's happening with the grumble? It's hell on earth in the end. So back to the main idea. God provides daily in order to starve the grumbler within. To feed the disciple. So God provides manna daily in order to starve the grumbler and feed the disciple. Behold, we're told by God, I'm about to rain down bread from heaven, and the people shall go out and gather a day's portion every day, every day. This bread they will call manna, and then Moses gives further instructions, and they will gather it, each of them, as much as they can eat. Morning by morning they will go out and gather this. So God provides manna daily to starve the grumbler and feed the disciple. He is the kind of God who provides for our needs on an everyday basis. He is the God who is with his people every step of the way to give them by his own hand daily provision in the wilderness to get them safely to the promised land. And think about this, as this is the God who is in the desert giving for his people, the God throughout all of history who is with us in all of our situations, giving us provisions daily. Think about the connection now to Jesus, God the Son, when he teaches us to pray. Give us today our daily bread. And he warns us not to build bigger barns with the mindset of the rich fool who put his security in serving himself, who put his hope in the future he could build and store for himself. Jesus teaches us rather that our security and our hope are in the Father's daily active care. So he feeds us so that we might trust him. So that in discipleship we would give ourselves wholly and trust to God and the way God is running the world. And this is an astounding display of God's power by doing this daily. But knowing this, like knowing this daily provision, this is real rest. That no matter where you are, no matter who you are, no matter what you call yourself or what you do, God says, I am with you. I have the willingness and the power to make abundant provision for you. I will feed you beyond anything you can ever imagine. So morning by morning, they ate bread and meat. They filled their stomachs. And somehow, by eating bread and meat morning by morning to fill their stomachs, it was for the purpose of God also starving the grumbler. How so? It was divine power, divine compassion, and is meeting everything you need. If God were only holy and powerful, if God was only sovereign and had no compassion, we would all be ruined, first off. But if God was only holy and powerful and sovereign, no one of us would ever run to him. No one of us would look up and say, oh yeah, all of our hope is in him. Manna shows us it is compassion, in his compassion that his sovereignty is exercised for our good, that his power is released for provision, that his holiness is leveraged not to create distance between him and sinners, but his holiness is something that even leads him to send his one and only Son, so that through the life and the death of Jesus Christ, justification and forgiveness and righteousness would flow from Jesus on the cross into your life. It is this divine holiness and divine compassion, God leveraging his strength to fill you, which is meant to starve the grumbler inside you. God also provides, I would say this is 1B, really. God provides the Sabbath in order to starve the grumbler and feed the disciples. Think about it, 6 days of production, 7 days of provision. That's the Sabbath. It's to let you know, using Eugene Peterson's words, that the anxiety system of Pharaoh is over. Even when you don't produce, God will meet every need. His grace is sufficient, his love is abounding. And it's good for our discipleship because it requires us to trust him, to rest our heads and let God be God. It's good for us because a Sabbath dethrones us, that we know over and over again, each week on a Sabbath, we can't operate by our own strength. It's this rhythm of our lives where we say, God, you are the one who does the work. When I stop, you don't. When I stop accomplishing, your interest in me has not failed. You are the source and the sustainer. Your energy accomplishes all of these things, and I'm just living in it. And this kind of grace built into our weeks and built into our days, this kind of grace drains the nutrients straight out of grumbling. Because a grumbler says this, I've done and I've done and I've done and I've done and I've done, and this is the things I get from God. But a Sabbath tells us, I've done nothing. I wake up each day to a world I didn't make. I wake up each day to a salvation I didn't earn. God has done it all. He has met all our needs. Number two, God provides the desert in order to starve the grumbler and feed the disciple. Some people will learn when they are full. In fact, I see it in our congregation all the time. God has met your needs so graciously. His grace has hit home, and you have such compassion for people when you are full. Some of you don't. So some people learn when they're full, and some people only learn when they are empty and experience hunger. There's this desert wandering. The whole story is set in this. This is God teaching and discipling through the desert, through wandering, through pain, through lack, and waiting on provision. This is God even teaching and discipling through, if you gather too much on one day of this manna, you know what happens to it? You get maggots in it, and it stinks. God gives maggots. Starve the grumbler, and feed the disciple. In the desert, you ask yourself really hard questions. And hard questions are so important for the journey of discipleship. To become the right person means you have to make the right kind of decisions, which means you've asked yourself the right kinds of questions. And the good, hard questions of the desert are like sandpaper on the soul, refining the disciple, whittling away the grumbler. You know, God describes this time in the desert as a time of testing his people. It's not like a test, like God is like, hey, here's a test, I hope you fail, and I'm watching you, right? No, testing his people in the sense of God is refining his people. As parents, each and every day, if you have parents out here, you have a choice. Will you make your children happy or will you make your children durable? It's a difference in discipling and disciplining your kids and ruining them. It's a test of parenthood. This is what God is doing in the desert, testing them to refine them, whittling away the grumbler, refining the disciple. And in the desert, you ask yourself the hard question that if you do get this thing, right, remember the thing that you had to have to make your life complete, to satisfy you fully? In the desert, you ask the question, I had it. Where is it now? Did it save me? No. And I had this. Where is it now? Did it save me? No. And I had this. Did it satisfy? Did it give me rest? You have to ask the hard questions in the desert until your eyes are lifted up, until you recognize that you truly prefer the love of Christ above all things. And finally this. God provides his word in order to starve the grumbler and feed the disciple. God gives his word to feed us, to guide us into salvation, for releasing chains, for calling death into life inside of us. Jesus recognized the tie between the desert and the man in the desert and God's word. Matthew 3:3-4. And the tempter, this is the story of Jesus' temptation. The tempter came and said to him, if you're the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread. But he answered, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. Jesus recognized that the real food in the desert was God's word. And so this temptation comes to Jesus. And the Satan comes to Jesus and says, be the kind of Messiah, be the kind of Savior who skips over the human experience. There's rocks, you need bread, make them into bread and eat. It is this temptation to offer Jesus everything with no difficult parts of the incarnation, to make bread without the fixed rules of hunger, to be a cosmic king who can skip the cross. And Jesus says, no, I'm fed by the words that come from the mouth of my Father. Jesus tells us that he knows what will feed him. He tells us that the real feast of life is God's word for life, for mission, for God's glory. Every word comes from the Father and is food for his soul. Here's our problem, here's our grumble, is that in our gut, unlike Jesus in the wilderness, in our gut, we trust our gut, we trust our feelings, we trust our instincts, we trust our street smarts, we trust our knowledge about the way the world works, above trusting the God who made the world. God's word teaches us to doubt that about us, that our guts and our street smarts and our understanding of the world will get us through. God's word comes to us with wonderful promises, like man in the desert, it'll be there for you. And God's word comes to us with wonderful commands, gather only what you need for today. Despite your street smarts, and how you can do math about bread, gather what you need for today. And God's word will lead us into some difficult places, but it's in order for us to see God rightly through his word. And seeing God rightly through his word stirs the affections of our souls, that everything might be brought into right relationship with him. Seeing God rightly through his word so that everything might be brought into conformity with the goal of Jesus Christ in our lives. Seeing God rightly leads to progressive sanctification and growth and humility and godliness. And every time seeing God rightly through his word leads to death being swallowed into life for us. So we end here. God provides his very son in order to silence the grumble deep in your heart and make you a disciple. If you're here this morning with us and you don't know Jesus personally, meaning you haven't trusted him for salvation, I need you to know that there is a grumble deep in your heart against God. Because really, underneath everything in your life, there's unbelief. And that unbelief drives the resistance to God. It drives resistance to every direction of the Lord. So here's what God himself has done to overcome that grumble and to win you with his love. John 6, he These are the words of Jesus. Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever believes in me has eternal life. I am the bread of life. Your fathers ate manna in the wilderness, and they died. This is the bread that comes down from heaven, so that one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If anyone eats this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh. The Jews then disputed among themselves, saying, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? That's actually a pretty good question. So Jesus said to them, truly, truly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. In John chapter 6, Jesus is looking back to the manna in the wilderness, bread from heaven. And Jesus is looking forward to the cross. And Jesus is saying, I am living bread that comes down from heaven. I will feed you beyond what you can possibly imagine. You will never hunger, and you will never thirst. You will have eternal life. And how does he do it? Is it through your own self-service? No. Is it through your own merit? No. Is it because you have so much skin in the game, you'll get to no hunger and no thirst? No. He says this bread from heaven is connected with eating his flesh and drinking his blood. In other words, he who trusts in me, he who places his faith in my broken body on the cross, in my shed blood on the cross, he shall live forevermore. This morning, if you don't know Jesus Christ, can't you, want you, lay down your resistance to him? It is his skin in the game that satisfies you. And for all of us gathered here this morning, as we move into a time of song and response, we have so much need. And the Lord Jesus Christ himself will feed us till we hunger and we thirst no more. Let's pray together and we'll sing. Father in heaven, we pray in the moments ahead for one simple response. That we turn our trust and our attention and our affection to you. You give us rest and you satisfy our souls. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Will you stand with me and sing?
Like mine can be so.
As we go out this morning, let me remind you of a few things. You are invited to give as an act of worship this morning of your tithes and of your offerings. The offering plate's located behind you in the foyer, and we're so grateful for your generosity, how you support ministry here week after week, day after day. You're invited this week into some opportunities for prayer. Tuesday morning prayers here at 7 a.m. in the sanctuary, also a prayer room dedicated for just getting away, spending some time with the Lord in prayer, located off of our fellowship hall. You can come by there anytime during the day. Golden Circle has a trip on Tuesday. They'll leave at 9 a.m. to go to Ella J., Georgia. Youth Choir meets tonight at 4:45. And then, of course, you see in the bulletin Wednesday night meals for the upcoming weeks. Make sure you make those reservations or cancel those reservations, whatever bucket you're in currently, by 3 p.m. tomorrow by calling into the office or emailing the office or responding through our text message service. I've said a lot of words already. I'm done. All right. Tonight, please come back tonight, 6 p.m., an ordination service for our four new deacons coming on for this term. It's a special night of worship and prayer and being able to pray for them. And so 6 p.m. Here tonight. And I believe that is it. It's in your bulletins. Take a look, please. Would you stand with me? And we'll speak and pray our benediction as the Lord sends us out into Sunday school classes this morning. May the beauty of God be reflected in our lives. The love of God be reflected in our hands. The wisdom of God be reflected in our words. And the knowledge of God flow from our hearts, that all might see, and seeing, believe. Grace and peace.